Okay, so my talk is about semantics, about induction of semantic representations, and the key word here is induction. So it's basically we will be trying to induce representations from the data itself. So rather than getting linguists to provide rules or maybe annotate data, we'll try to see how we can actually induce representations. And of course, a big question is, what do I mean by semantics? What do I mean by semantic representations? And I hope this will be clear in a few moments. Okay, so these are a few people who contributed to this project. So that's basically my students, postdocs. So some of them are already at a bit different place. So things changed. But these are people who really did much of this work. Okay, so why semantic representations? So let's just have a look in a very simple case in a question answering system. So you have a question and you need to find an answer in a collection, so say in a biomedical collection. And this is not something I imagine, that's actually some kind of answers provided by the system we have. So in the first case, you need to understand that suppress and block mean essentially the same thing in this biomedical context, and also to understand how to map the arguments between the two. And in the second case, TNF alpha, you need to understand the TNF alpha and tumor necrosis factor alpha, again, refer basically to the same concept, to the same entity. So what I mean by semantics is a type of abstraction from specifics of surface realization, from words, from lexical information, and from syntax. And maybe something you also can do a little bit of reasoning on top of. So the semantics I will be discussing in my talk has already been shown to be useful in a number of applications. Maybe it wasn't really central to these applications, to be honest, but I think it's still very encouraging because we are not really good at predicting these representations. We really don't know how to do this well yet, but even these noisy representations we'll be discussing seem to be already helpful. And of course, there are many applications which are not even possible without thinking about semantics, without thinking about some kind of semantic parsing. So this is what starts to be fashionable in recent years, is what's called machine reading, is ability to extract knowledge from text and maybe do some kind of reasoning, question answering on the basis of this knowledge. So that's an outline of the talk. So I'll start by more formally defining what I'm actually trying to do, so more formally defining my task. And then, of course, a big question, how we can induce these representations? Why I even think that it's possible? So what kind of signals are contained in actually unlabeled data, in unannotated text? And then when we have an idea of these signals, we can think how we can encode them in a probabilistic model. So that's the second part, and how we can do inference. So how can we actually learn this model and use this model? And then, of course, an important point, actually, whether this works. So that's an evaluation. And so far, this will be more like presented like a success story. So everything works great. But in reality, there are many shortcomings to this model. And that's why we're actually doing this research, to understand properties of the task, understand properties of the models we use. And this suggests maybe some other ideas how we can actually address these challenges. And this will be the very last part of the talk, and it's about the work we are doing actually now. Obviously, I'm more excited about the current work than all the past work, so, but wait until the very end. Okay, so we know fairly well how to perform syntactic parsing. So we have fairly accurate, maybe not perfect, but fairly robust and actually relatively fast parsers for dozens of languages. So, but this is not really semantics. So the syntactic representations they present don't really encode even basic forms of semantics. So for example, in this case, you see that Jack is a subject of this predicate open, and then you have a preposition or phrase with a paperclip attached to this predicate, but it doesn't even specify who did what, to whom, why, and etc. So it doesn't even specify the underlying predicate argument structure. So one way of discussing predicate argument structure, thinking of predicate argument structure, is thinking of in terms of frame semantics. This, so in frame semantics, you use a notion of a frame, and the frame describes an event or an object along with its properties or participants. So say you have a very simple sentence. So Jack opens a lock with a paperclip. So here we have what's called in FrameNet closure opening frame. So something is closing or opening. And you have only three participants. So there is an agent, so someone who is performing the action, the active participants, and agent is semantic role. We will refer to this as semantic role. Then there is a patient, an affected entity, and there is an instrument. But there are many more roles which, in principle, can be realized for this frame. But in this very simple case, they are not really realized. So we can actually also represent it as a graph. So that's one potential representation. So you have here labels on top of words, on top of predicates, say they're semantic frames, refer to semantic frames, and then you have agents which show you arguments, and you have labels on top of these edges, which are semantic roles. Okay, so why is this hard? I know for many of you who actually work, so people at Yandex, I think it's fairly obvious why this is hard, right? But let's think of a very simple situation, John breaking a window. So you can express it even using this predicate in a few different ways. So that's on the left, and this is called alternations. And in the first case, syntactic subject is also an agent. So John is an agent. Whereas in the second case, syntactic subject is not agent anymore, it's actually patient. So by the way, colors will refer mostly to different semantic roles in the talk. But then there are also many ways how you can represent the same semantics using different verbs, or not necessarily even verbs. So this, and we basically want to map all these different things, all this variability, into the same semantic frame representation. And this is what makes this task hard. And I would argue that actually it makes supervised learning for this task not particularly promising, because we all of us know that words have a very long tail distributions. So there are many non-frequent words, non-frequent constructions. They are rare, but in total, they constitute a significant mass. And semantics is very much connected to words. So you really need to have huge amount of annotations. So maybe purely supervised learning is not the way to go. So what we want to do? We want to predict these semantic dependency graphs. So these semantic dependency graphs are actually fairly recursive because arguments or frames can evoke their own frame. So we have now first a wearing frame, which has an argument dress, but dress has its own frame because it can be characterized by different properties. And then also different frames might be evoked not by by single words, but by multi-word constructions as well. So that's what we want to induce, this type of basically graphs, direct acyclic graphs. So we want to induce them in this talk in annotated from annotated text, but I mean the general goal, of course, we don't want to get rid of linguistic supervision. We want to use different types of resources, so we should think of semi-supervised learning, of course. But for now, that's unsupervised. So since we're inducing this from unannotated data, of course, we are not going to get these fancy, nice names for roles and frames. What we will get are some kind of indices, which will basically refer to some kind of mixture components in our probabilistic models. So that's what we will be inducing, but maybe that's not a problem. So because if you really need these labels, you can just label these frames and roles. It's much easier than labeling the data, much less effort. Or then if you don't, but really we don't need them often, because what we do anyway, we use these representations in some kind of pipeline, so we convert them to features, and implicitly you convert them to indices anyway, so why do we care about names? So that's probably not really a limitation of this technique. So now I want to discuss signals. So what kind of information we hope to use? But before this, let's think what kind of subtask we actually have. So first one is basically argument identification. So we want to get some kind of syntactic representation which reflects more semantics and not only syntax. I'll get back to this perhaps, or I will be happy to take more questions about it later on. But then what we want to induce frames on top of this, which basically means that we want to segment this graph into paths and label these paths. And then we also want to label relations between these paths, and this will be a role induction step. So what I would argue here is that the first step is not the most interesting one, because we can handle it fairly well with heuristics, at least for verbal predicates, and then you don't really need to rely on words that much to perform this task. I mean, it's a little bit of a lie, but it's to some degree true, so there is it's more true than a lie, I would say. And there is another reason why this task is not very interesting in the context of this talk, because there is very little signal in unlabeled data. So that would be a little bit naive to try to induce it in an unsupervised way. So that's not something we will be worrying about today. So what we will be worrying about is the second and the third stages. And we will model these two tasks jointly, and as I will argue, that's actually a key point to do this joint modeling of frame and row induction. And this is actually different from much of previous work for this task, because previously people consider it sense disambiguation as independent task, multi-word expression induction as independent task, row labeling as independent, and then you just put this annotation together. And what we see, it's actually useful to do this in a joint way. Okay, how do we induce semantic frames? So first of all, about terminology. So I'm not trying to learn what is semantic frame and what is not semantic frame, what is just a cluster of words. Why? Because even semanticists don't really don't have very good criteria for deciding what is not, what is semantic frame, what is not semantic frame. So basically, we assume that every part belongs, if this dependency representation belongs to some semantic class. All right, so that's an assumption. We are not trying to solve a problem which even people can't do. So that's one point I want to mention. But what also what we have to do if we induce semantic classes? First of all, we need to basically decide that lexemes which have similar meaning in a given context should be basically go together, should be clustered together. But also, as I mentioned, that's also induction of multi-word expressions, so things like red herrings or idiomatic expressions, or maybe something which is not sufficiently composition or not composition in a usual way as light verb constructions. And of course, this is done within a joint inference in some probabilistic model. So when you induce multi-word expression, later on you might decide to cluster this together with a single word. So now I'll mention three signals of semantic relatedness we use in our models. And these signals shouldn't really come into as a surprise for you if you follow what's going on in computational linguistics. So that's basically just one way to formulate a standard selection of preferences as an assumption. So the point is roles for related predicates are filled with similar arguments. So that's one signal I'm using. And then we can, why is this actually true? So we can look for now in some annotated data set. So I'm not using annotated data set for learning, but let's just have a look whether this assumption is true. So we have two related predicates, to wear and to dress in. So I think all of us agree that they're kind of very similar, so we would want to cluster perhaps them, at least in one of the senses. And then we can look into fillers of arguments for wearer role and clothing role and see whether they match. And we see that there is some kind of overlap. So you can see I tried to underline it with a color. So certainly there is an overlap. But there is one catch here. So we don't have roles really in our data, right? So we want to induce roles. And that's, basically that's an argument for inducing roles before frames. But we will have arguments in the opposite direction, why inducing frames might help induction of roles. And that's kind of intuition why joint induction of frames and roles actually helps us. And then we actually don't model a distribution over lexemes. We don't model distribution over words. We will be modeling within this joint model. We will be modeling distribution over semantic classes. So again, this joint modeling point. So I can speculate, of course, the speculation that is much more obvious if you have semantic classes to see that they're semantically related. But what basically will be happening, you learn semantic classes which help you to do this other parts of semantic clustering task, because you learn them together. So they kind of specialize to each other. So that's an important bit. Okay, so joint learning at this stage may be helpful. That's what we say. Okay, the second signal is again selection of preferences, but kind of other way around. So what I'm saying here is that similar arguments fill slots, fill roles for similar sets of predicates. So if you take something like a short and uniform, which are kind of related, they're not perfectly the same, but the garment. And you will see that, again, the set of predicates they participate in is related. And again, what will be happening, we will be modeling this on the level of semantic classes, on the level of frames. Okay, so third signal relies on intuition coming from linguistics, and maybe some of you are familiar with Levin classes, but what they basically represent are sets of predicates which have similar mapping between syntax and semantics, similar syntax-semantic interface. And usually what was observed that such verbs are semantically similar as well. So, for example, this is one of Levin classes, a class of verbs of transfer of message, and they're basically characterized by two properties. They both can undergo a dative shift, dative alternation. So you can say John taught linguistics to the student, or John taught the students linguistics, so both of these are quite acceptable. And you also can use them in that constructions. So that's the characterization of these Levin classes. And you can see that what you get are predicates which are actually quite semantically related. And this again relies on a notion of semantic roles, so we need to induce semantic roles. We are not using Levin classes, so we're not using Levin's book, and then we wrote down these classes and use separate knowledge. But we just use this as an idea that syntactic behavior is predictive of semantic properties. So if we include a model syntax semantic interface, it should us provide some information about semantics. But we shouldn't overdo this as well. For example, in these verbs of transfer of knowledge, I think there are a few things which don't really belong here. For example, I think preach is also here, right? We hope that teaching and preaching is not really the same, right? And so you should use this signal. It's useful, but it shouldn't be the only signal. Okay, so that was about inducing semantic classes. So how do we induce roles? What kind of information do we use for inducing roles? First of all, what does it mean to induce roles? So for now, let's think that we already induce frames and we know where arguments are. So that's basically a situation like this. So you know, you have this frame teaching, you know where arguments are, and you want to figure out how to cluster these arguments. So you want to color them in some way, right? So that's clustering task. In principle, since we want to do it within a probabilistic model, we could apply just some kind of mixture model, and we will get some clustering. The problem is that it's extremely expensive. And within joint modeling, what's happening, we want to do this clustering multiple times. So we will be inducing semantic classes, then we will basically re-estimating these roles, we re-estimate frames, and so on. So we really want this to be efficient, and the point, we want to use a large amount of data, right? And this is not going to work if we just approach it in a direct way. So what can we do? So idea here is pretty simple, but somewhat limiting, as you will see. So what we do, we identify argument occurrences, arguments, with some properties of the syntactic frame, syntactic signatures. So say you have this an example. So that's called a locative preposition drop alternation. So you can say, Mary climbed up the mountain, or you can drop the preposition and say, Mary climbed the mountain. So we can identify the second argument in both cases with some properties. So the simplest one would be, for example, this. So you just tell what is syntactic dependency, what kind of voice you have, whether it's active or passive voice, and position with the respect of predicate. And then, and then you see the difference. So in the first case, you have prepositional modification with the preposition up. In the second case, you have a direct object. So that's the only difference, is these two argument keys. So why this argument keys? How do you design this argument keys? Okay, that's basically the only language-specific component in this model. So you design them in such a way that they mostly map to a single semantic role. And then instead of clustering occurrences of argument, you basically define a clustering model in terms of clustering these argument keys. And in this case, we would just want to cluster these argument keys together. If you have more complex alternations, like a dative shift we saw three slides ago, then you need to have more pairs of argument keys clustered together. So basically use clustering of argument keys as a kind of proxy for clustering arguments. So what kind of signals? Signals are, again, pretty standard. So one is selection of preferences. Again, if you see that two argument keys basically have similar arguments corresponding to them, there is a chance that they encode the same type of argument. And then one property which is actually very useful, but very simple, is also has been used a lot, for example, in supervised context, that the same argument role is unlikely to occur twice. So you want to integrate this information as well. So you don't want, in this case, to say linguistic and students correspond to the same role. So that's not very likely. Okay, so this slide is meant not to really for you to read that much, but really show, okay, we now have all these assumptions, and now what we want to translate these assumptions in a probabilistic model. And so that's the next part. Okay, let's recall our setup. So what we have in our data is other sentences with this argument identification, basically basic transformation on top of syntax done. So that's our basically X, that's our observables. And what we want to induce on top of this meaning representation, semantic representation M, which would be segmentation, basically, and clustering of original representation. And recall, we are really not inducing names of frames and roles, we induce in indices. Okay, so that's generative modeling. So approach by generative modeling, I think most of you are probably familiar with generative modeling to some degree. So what you do, you basically define a family of probabilistic models which associate a probability with meaning, sentence, information with words and syntax. So basically you make assumptions how words, how syntax, how semantic representations are jointly generated. You also have some priors, and you, for example, can encode a natural prior that the same frame can be verbalized in a few different ways, but you don't want to have a flat distribution of a vocabulary, or maybe flat distribution of a dependency tree fragments. So you want to have some kind of sparsity. So that's one assumption which is easy to encode in a prior. And then, since we want to be Bayesian, what we want to basically, rather than estimating a single parameter, we want to basically average, marginalize our parameters. So we are not believing any model. We want to treat this parameter vector theta as a random variable as well. Okay, so now I will describe the model. So on the left, I will have a generative story. So that's basically assumptions. How I assume the data is generated. So that's not algorithm for parsing, it's just assumptions, it's definition of probabilistic model. And on the right, you will see an example of this sentence, this semantically annotated sentence generated step by step. So first, what you do, you have a distribution, in this case, it's theta, which associates a distribution of dependency fragments, or no, distribution of semantic classes at the root of the sentence. So for now, let's think this is a tree. It's not really important, it's not what we do, but let's think semantic representation is not direct acyclic graph, but more specifically, it's a tree. So say you generate from this distribution a semantic class request. Now you go and generate it. So the first thing you have this phi, which is a distribution, basically distribution over different dependency tree fragments, which can be used to realize this semantic class request. So in this case, we generated gave an order, but it might have request, asked, and et cetera as potential realizations. And then in a simplest model, we just independently go over roles, and we decide if we want to generate this role or not. And if you want, we start generating this role by first drawing argument key from the distribution associated with this role. And then we draw a semantic class for an argument. So that's basically modeling selection of preferences. So requests are usually speakers for requests are usually people. So you generate a person in this case, and then you have a recursion. So there is not much to recurse. For example, you have a Peter the Great here. And then you go over, you know, you continue generating other roles, and you recurse down the tree. And so in the end, you get the whole structure generated. Is this basic idea of probabilistic model is clear? So basically generated in parts, and we generated from distributions specific to frames, to roles in these frames, and et cetera. Okay. So this is slide is not meant to scare you, but it's really to show what's going on under the hood, because it's always pity you spent all the time actually working on modeling inference, and then you never mention things you did. But for some of you who might be familiar with Bayesian machinery, there might be many relevant keywords, and you might have a better idea what's going on. So I will only mention in more details the point five, because I think it's actually something which is not very well known, at least in NLP community, but even in machine learning community, and it's quite useful outside of the context of this task, so maybe there is a chance you will find it useful as well. So what happened to the, what was standard in unsupervised induction? So we are not the first to do this, and we will compare to previous work, that previous models consider it predicate by predicate. So they induced models for each predicate independently. So from one point of view, it kind of makes sense because a syntax-semantic interface changes from one predicate to another, of course. That's the whole problem, what makes it, it hard. But it's not like you use a new language for each predicate. So the space of potential alternation patterns is much more limited. So it doesn't seem right. So so every clustering of argument keys, I mean, generally clustering, basically they encode the possible alternations, and these alternations are reused. So we saw this dative shift, and we say that it applies to predicate div, but it also applies to a number of other predicates, like predicates row. So you certainly don't want to induce it independently. And also, there are some predicates for which it's much easier to induce because selection of preference signal is much more predictive. So for example, change and to freeze, they have the same pattern of alternations. They belong to the same Levin class. But change, it's very hard to induce semantic roles for change because you can basically change anything. You can change your mind, you can change, try to change other people, or you can change, you know, resolution on your screen. So they're not restrictive, so the directional preference signal won't really work. But you, you know, predicate of freeze is much more limited. You generally, for example, don't freeze people, right? So unless it's kind of very, very scary story, right? But so it's certainly it's another argument why we want to do this jointly. So it's because we want to pass this information across different predicates. So but how can we do this? So first of all, very basic intuition. So what we want to keep track of how likely two argument keys are to go together. So you can think of this kind of matrix. So where you have similarity scores, which you want to learn for every pair of argument keys. And what happens intuitively, what we want to happen, and then I'll explain how more statistically this is encoded, that intuitively, first you can try to induce for different predicates independently, say for predicate open and predicate overtake. But then you're likely to make a mistake. So this red blob is basically wrong. And then you re-estimate these general preferences, and hopefully you are more correct than wrong, and then when you perform re-estimation again for individual predicates, you'll get things right. So that's an intuition. So you want in some way, you know, average, encode this shared information across different predicates. So I wonder who is actually familiar with Chinese restaurant processes or Dirichlet processes in the audience? Okay, so few people. So maybe maybe that would be also useful view, because, but not with distance dependent Chinese restaurant process. Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, that's a bit unusual actually. Okay, anyway. So what's Chinese restaurant process is doing? It's basically you can think of this as a distribution over partitions of objects. And it's fairly standard to use here this Chinese restaurant metaphor to describe this distribution. So you have tables, and this is a very, very large Chinese restaurant, so we have infinite number of tables. So when customers enter, it sits in different tables. And so let's assume for now that there are two customers sitting at the first table, and there is this, one customer sitting at the second table, and no other customers in the restaurant. So you now consider where to seat the next customer, and you have essentially three possibilities, table one, table two, or take the next unoccupied table. And probability of sitting at the first table is proportional to two customers. A probability of sitting at the next table to one customer, the number of customers at this table, so one. And then there is some constant which is the score to which proportional the probability of sitting at the next table. So basically what this, and then if you multiply all these probabilities together, you will basically get a distribution of a partition of objects. And so what it's encoding? It's encoding this rich get richer dynamics. So you are more likely to sit at the table where many people are sitting. And this is useful thing because that's the type of distributions in general we have in natural language. So there are few components which have high probabilities, and there are many components which have lower probability. But this is maybe still a fairly simple distribution, fairly simple prior, it seems. But let's think of this in a bit different way. So instead of thinking that you are choosing a table, you can think that you're choosing a person to sit with. And if you are choosing a person uniformly among the previous people who entered the restaurant, and then you have some probability of sitting by yourself, then just it will be just equivalent to definition of Chinese restaurant process. So every connected component of this graph would correspond to a table, and this is nothing has changed. That's the same, just a different view. But I think this view is illuminating because it basically gives you some idea. So why uniformly choosing different different people? You might have some preferences, right? So you might sit with colleagues from your department, or you know, just nice people you like talk to. So that's you can imagine a richer set of models which are parameterized by this similarity D. And that's what we exploit in our model. So basically, we will be inducing this similarity D and share this across different clustering of argument keys for different predicates for different frames. There are a few subtle moments for those of you who are really machine learning people, but I wouldn't really mention this, but I'd be happy to answer this question. Okay, so how do we actually use this model? So I define the model, but how do we use this? And we use it using basically a sampling algorithm. Okay, we have a few versions, but essentially what I want to mention is sampling. So on every step, so what is a sampler, if you're not familiar with this? It's basically like a search in the set of this configuration. So you start with a random configuration, so random semantics, you randomly label your data set, and then you're trying to change this labeling, so you have some proposal, and then you can see if probability goes up or going down. If it's going up, you accept this change. If it's going down, you mostly reject the change. Right? So that's kind of intuition of, you know, poor man's intuition to sampling. But the inference here is challenging. So the search space is really huge. And you have, you know, to think how to structure this search in this space. And it's fairly natural to think of different types of moves here. So we have moves which basically perform role induction for a given predicate, so re-estimate roles for a given frame. Then there are moves which correspond to splitting and merging two semantic classes together, and then composing and decomposing semantic classes together. So that's the sampler we use. But that's not the only possibility. For example, there was an alternative sampler for our model proposed very recently. Okay, that's basically, you know, I can't really go into technical details, but I guess it gives you some flavor for what's going on. Now let's get some idea how this actually works. So first, about role evaluation, how good we are at inducing roles. And it's tricky to evaluate unsupervised models, right? Because this is essentially a clustering problem, and it's really hard to evaluate clustering problems as well. So you can evaluate it by comparing what linguists think, but see how your clustering are correlated with predictions of linguists. And that's what we do for now. But you also can look at applications, and that's what we will do in the next slide, in the two slides. So what are the clustering measures? So there is a purity measure, which is basically measures the degree to which induced role corresponds to a single correct role, to gold standard role, to the role provided by the linguist. And collocation is kind of other way around, so degree to which every gold role corresponds to a single induced role. And it's natural to try to optimize harmonic mean between these two. It's not the only possibility. There are a few possibilities, but I'll mention only this one. Okay, so what do we have here? I think I probably should have increased this table. You will see a larger version of table. But there are a few approaches which were considered state of the art before. And there is our approach, and we get a bit of improvement. And for this task, it's actually quite a bit of improvement, because you don't expect for unsupervised systems the scores of, you know, 100%, because unsupervised model is not even informed by the linguistic framework, linguistic guidelines used by annotators. So there is one disturbing moment here. I was, emphasizing a lot that syntax doesn't provide enough signal for semantic role labeling, but actually optimal mapping from syntactic functions to semantic roles perform fairly well, at least well comparing to previous models. There is a good part to this, because if you actually evaluate this on syntax which is predicted by the parser, in this case syntax was gold standard, so it was correct. This margin, this difference between our system and syntax increases, and you can look it up in our paper. I don't have this here, because I can't compare it to previous work, since it doesn't really compare, since you use different syntactic parsers. But the system seems to be robust and compensate on some errors. Okay. Okay. So then if you look what actually this model is inducing, so we'll see that it's inducing what we more or less expected to induce. Okay, to be comparable to previous work, we're doing a really stupid thing. We also induce passive voice. You know, why would you want to induce passive voice? But we, of course, do this well. And then you induce also a number of more interesting things, so, such things like new equivalents of subordinating conjunctions, prepositions. Also detect alternations, at least the frequent ones, and maybe sometimes not perfectly, but to a large degree. So it seems to do what we more or less expected it to do. And then, now if you look into what kind of semantic classes it induces, it looks in generally quite well as well. So that's actually just 10 first semantic classes. I haven't really cherry-picked this. But also, you know, it seems to be nice because these are different blood cells, and I think they're even white blood cells. I'm not a biologist, I have no idea. But you also see problems because it clusters also things which are not really equivalent, so different types, still different blood cells. And then if you want to use it, for example, for question answering task, you will be asking question about one blood cell and get answers about the different ones. So it doesn't sound like a very good if you do it directly. And then what we also have, we, for example, have these frames, which I show because it really matches very nicely to what is in FrameNet. In FrameNet, they call this course change position on a scale. But it's really specific to this biomedical domain because, of course, FrameNet linguists wouldn't think of verbs like upregulate or abrogate and et cetera, which are basically jargon used in this area. Okay, so how do we evaluate it on a question answering task? So that's the task I was mentioning in the very beginning of our talk. So the few systems I'm comparing our model with, the first one is quite stupid. It's just matching of keywords, just words as basically as a bag, and then syntactic match. So what you see, syntactic match, okay, so I need to explain what is actually green and red. So green is a number of questions answered correctly. Red is a number of mistakes. And some questions we are not answering because it just didn't find answer in the text. So that's why bars have a different height. So this is standard information extraction methods because you actually can use some clustering methods from information extraction in a question answering context. And you can see that our system and what is Markov logic networks of Poon and Dominguez outperform these other models by a big margin. And our hypothesis that this has to do with joint modeling, because it's basically just models, relations, model frames independently from anything else. Okay, so we're still not doing better than Markov logic networks. But I think this, first of all, this difference really not significant. We just don't have enough, you know, examples in this case. And the main reason is actually, I was mentioning these three semantic classes, two semantic classes before, and these two out of the three actually the problem, because they're two cores. So that's what I mentioned before. So I was kind of, from one perspective, proud of inducing this change position on a scale frame. But then you have antonyms in there, like increase and decrease, and they are the same. And it's not surprising because they appear in the same context usually. So distributional signal is very similar. So Markov logic networks actually use some heuristic to get rid of this, and we are not doing it. So that's probably the reason. But they also perform joint modeling. Okay. Still, I think this illustrates the power of this approach. You can actually extend this approach in a number of ways. So you can think of semi-supervised learning. So we had a paper on this. And you can think of cross-lingual extensions. So basically, you can use parallel data and enforce some agreement on parallel data. And actually, it leads to some improvements for semantics or for every part. For best parts, we induce. And then you can also go beyond this. You can try to learn how these semantic frames are organized in more complex activities. So for example, when you go to a restaurant, you first wait to get seated, then you sit at a table, you read the menu, and etc. So this type of things you can also try to learn. It's all hard, it doesn't work perfectly well, but I think that's some type of knowledge we need. But it's not perfect, not nearly perfect. And so what I think is not done very well in this model. So first of all, this model relies on a very restricted set of features. So basically, it relies on these argument keys. And in learning, it relies on words for to induce this clustering. But it's very, very feature-poor model. And this is very different from what people do in supervised semantic role labeling, where it's very important to use many features. So this probably still works for English. We saw that it works for a few other languages, but it's becoming more and more problematic as your language becoming more free order, and like Russian, for example, right? So you need, in this case, much richer features to capture this syntax semantic interface. So how do we integrate these rich features? And so why is also more important? Why is so important? Because basically, to be able to make this model work, you have to rely on syntax. And this model over-rely on syntax, essentially. So what happens, we will see that induces good clusters of predicates, but it can't cross a boundary between predicates and nouns. So you want to have some kind of clustering that X sent to Y is synonymous to Y is a shipment from X. This model is not capable of doing this because syntax is kind of saying, no, don't do this. Then you use, and it's not only us, I mean all the previous work on unsupervised induction, they use language-specific priors. And if you don't do this, your performance drops substantially. In our case, these are design of argument keys. And then because your features are not rich enough, your representations end up being too coarse. So it's you cluster antonyms together, opposites together, granularity is a little bit insufficient. So that's, and I think much of this actually stems from the fact that features are very restricted. You just can't use this signal efficiently because the model is so restricted. And you can't resolve this easily. That generative modeling doesn't really allow you to do it effectively. So how we can do this? How we can have a feature-rich framework which addresses all these problems? Okay, so let's look even in a simpler problem just to get an idea of how you can do this. So our goal in this case, so you know where arguments are, you know where basically frame is, but you don't know the role and the frame. And now I was arguing for the joint modeling, so forget for the moment joint modeling. So you just have this specific realization of frame. So tuple of arguments is what you observe, roles in frames, and the frame is what you want to induce. And again, you're not inducing names, you're inducing some kind of IDs. So how we can do this in a feature-rich way? So any latent variable model, you can think that what you do in latent variable model, you learn a representation which helps you to compress the input. So basically, your latent representation is a compression. So it encodes key properties so that you can reconstruct your data from this latent representation. So that happens in generative modeling as well. But we are making this very explicit in this work. So what we say, we want to hide one of the arguments. So for example, we hide this argument demonstrator, and we want to predict it looking at other arguments, the frame, and roles of these other arguments, and the target role as well. So what, since you know that agent is a police, patients, for example, can be, you know, some perpetrators, crime perpetrators, or maybe, you know, protesters, If you know the instrument, it's baton, and it also gives you some idea what this argument can be. It's less likely that it's, you know, a terrorist, right? So what you want to learn such a frames and such a roles which help these prediction tasks. So you hide an argument, and then you try to find how I can assign frames and roles in such a way that I can do this prediction as easily as possible. And why do I think these roles and frames will be really semantic roles and frames? So in some sense, that's what semantic frames and roles are for. You, the point is that if you see the frame and the role, you shouldn't worry about a specific order, about details of syntactic and realization. So all what, I mean, of course I'm lying again a little bit, but what all what you need to know is roles, frames, and these arguments. So you create this bottleneck. And what you do, you're not looking for this role in frames. What you do, you actually at the same time, you learn a parser, which predicts roles and frames. And so you propagate this information so you, to the parser. So you're trying to make the parser useful for this argument, feeling argument prediction task. And but how do you actually do this? And this idea in principle is really not so new idea, because it's something which standard in a narrow network community now called deep belief network, deep learning community. So there it's after encoders are one of the standard architectures. So you want to learn, for example, how to compress the image down to small representation, smaller vector, and such a way that you can reconstruct this image. And you optimize some kind of reconstruction error, and then this latent representation starts to capture key properties of the image. But this idea is really not limited to neural networks. So you can think of the same idea and apply it to linear models. And also, it doesn't necessarily need to be the case that encoding model and reconstruction model are the same. They can come from very different model families, and that's what we exploit here. So what we will have here, so we have this encoding model, which is just, for example, some kind of linear structured model, so log linear model, maybe conditional random fields. And so that's for compression, so it compresses to semantics, basically. And then you have argument prediction model, which is a tensor factorization model. So we'll see what I mean by tensor factorization and why I think it's relevant. So first, let's look into the reconstruction model. So you have representations of arguments, which are basically vectors, and you want to learn these vectors. And what you want in the end to have, for example, that representation of demonstrator is similar to representation of protester, because they're mostly substitutable, right? So that's your vector U you want to learn. Maybe you want to learn it not only from this data, but it's unimportant for now. And then you have also matrix, which is specific to frame and a role, which is assigned to this argument. When you multiply this U by the matrix, you basically have expectations about other arguments, right? So when you multiplied demonstrator by the matrix corresponding to the frame assault and a patient, you have a vector which basically tells you that, okay, we expect who assaults demonstrators. So maybe other demonstrators, or maybe the police, right? So something like this. And that's something you want to encode when in a representation when you multiply this U by matrix C. And then what you do, you basically just in a probabilistic model, you check if these expectations are met. So you have some kind of a pairwise factor. So you hear this information coming from the arguments you observe, and this is basically expectation coming from a potential argument you are considering. Can you see if they really match? So that's the type of a model you can use, and you don't need to predict individual arguments. So what you can think you are doing, you are basically defining a tensor factorization, which scores your tuples of arguments. And to be honest, this factorization I defined is not really, I'm sure that's not a very good one, so it has a number of problems. But this is an area which had a lot of already research done. So that's something which was considered, for example, a lot in the context of knowledge bases, knowledge-based completions. So we have, we know properties of tensor factorizations. But here what we basically reduced the problem to is to combine in ideas from tensor from statistical relational learning, how you perform inferences knowledge bases, and parsing into this knowledge bases. And we are doing this jointly. And interesting point that you can actually do this efficiently. Okay, and this is another component. So that's semantic parser. And for semantic parser, again, as I said, it can be just conditional random fields. So you have G, which is a representation, joint representation of rows, frames, and a sentence. And you have W parameters. And all what you basically will need to be able to do is to be able to efficiently compute posterior probabilities of rows and frames, or maybe approximate them. And not only compute, but also compute the gradients of this efficiently. And this is, for example, true for conditional random fields. So if you're familiar with conditional random fields or HMMs, you know that you use, you know what the forward and backward algorithms are. So what basically will be used happening, so you use forward and backward, compute posterior, and then you use again dynamic programming algorithm to backpropagate updates to parameters. So that's really efficient. Okay, so what do we actually optimize? So if you would know rows and frames, we would be just optimizing probability of argument given other arguments, rows and frames. So that's what's called sometimes basically pseudo-likelihood. But we don't know. So we have another model which predicts rows and frames, and we essentially optimize the log of expectation under this model, and we optimize it both with respect of parameters of factorization, so in our case it's a C in U, and with respect of parameters of a linear model. Oh, sorry, it's quite long, I need to finish up. I'm finishing up in a few moments. So this is not very tractable in its exact form, because of partition function, we marginalize over everything and et cetera. But there are a few tricks, standard tricks, we can reuse to be able to deal with the situation. And then training will be actually quite efficient because everything is bilinear or linear in our model. Okay, so how does it actually work? I don't know. Because we just started working on this. I know only for restricted setup where we look. We perform an induction of rows only. So basically, your predicate is your frame. And we're comparing it to all the previous models. And this is really not a very nice setup because we use the standard benchmark everyone is using for this unsupervised induction of rows, which is really little data setup, small data setup. So it's like 90,000 of predicate argument structures. And our model is very expressive. So that's not really where it should work well. And what we see, actually, this new model performs on par, I wouldn't say better, but on par with the Bayesian model I was just describing. And it doesn't have any kind of linguistic priors. We also applied to German, I also got state-of-the-art results on this. So it looks very, very promising. It has a few different properties. And one interesting property is that since we were lazy and decided not to implement it with frames, the model itself decided to induce frames. So it then induced rows specific to frames. So it split agent into different senses of the verb, for example. So that's not good. Okay, so this is it for this framework. I want just to mention that it's very nicely generalizable to semi-supervised learning because you can combine objective or likelihood objective with this reconstruction objective. You can perform learning for inferences because you can just not only remove arguments, you can remove the call record from the knowledge base and try to predict it. And you can use the same trick to model different relations on the document level because you can propagate this information through the factorization model. Okay, so these are conclusions, I mean general conclusions. So we basically know that rule-based semantic parsing doesn't work. It's not the way to go. I suspect most of the people here would agree with this. I also think that for open domain parsing, fully supervised is also not the way to go, and I think many people in the community at least would agree with me. So now the question is, what kind of resources we need to leverage? So what kind of resources are out there which we can use? And then we need to come up with something new, because something what we have is still doesn't perform as well as we want. So that's where we need, I think, to do research. And I think that's an exciting topic to think about. Thank you very much.
Есть время на серию вопросов и ответов, и поэтому, если вы хотите что-то спросить, то поднимите, пожалуйста, руку, я дам вам микрофон, и вы сможете в микрофон задать свой вопрос.
Здравствуйте. Меня интересует вопрос, можно ли где-то скачать библиотеку или посмотреть в онлайне работу семантического анализатора вашего? И второй вопрос — это связь нескольких предложений друг с другом.
Первый вопрос по анализатору. В принципе, здесь там есть несколько версий. То есть, конечно, я рассказываю в докладе, как будто это один анализатор, и у него есть такие свойства, но у меня на странице вы можете найти раздел software и в нем загрузите. Демо, к сожалению, как такового нет. Но это код на Java, который вы можете запустить и посмотреть, что происходит. Source код. Есть проблема, что, собственно, обучающие данные я не могу предоставить, а по той причине, что это LDC, это требует лицензии. Но если у вас есть, например, потому что это обучается поверх синтаксиса, поверх пентрибанка или QNL данных, поэтому вы можете найти эти данные. Если у вас в вашей организации есть доступ, то вы сможете их просто реплицировать. Связь между разными приложениями. Да, моделирую я независимо отдельные приложения, или я пытаюсь использовать контекст в документе, что-то в этом роде, да?
Логические связи всех, что код пошел. Там за молоком, это животное, и так далее.
Мы сейчас как раз в рамках последнего проекта, это то, чем мы планируем заниматься. На данный момент этого не происходит, но, собственно, этого не происходит практически ни в какой работе в NLP сейчас. Практически все продукты, которые, и решения, какие есть, и методы, они анализируют приложение отдельно. Это, конечно, неправильно. Но и как раз матричная факторизация о чем я говорил, позволяет нам это решить, я думаю, потому что если мы залинкуем разные аргументы, сделаем кореференс на уровне документа, инференсы могут передаваться через latent factors в модели факторизации. И это то, чем мы сейчас как раз занимаемся и смотрим, насколько хорошо это работает. Но это большая проблема, да.
Сейчас до того, как мы зададим следующий вопрос, хочу напомнить тем, кто нас смотрит в онлайн-трансляции, что вы можете написать свой вопрос в Twitter с хэштегом YaScience. Он есть внизу страницы с трансляцией. И тогда я зачитаю ваш вопрос.
Спасибо за очень интересный доклад, который сочетает в себе применение таких разнородных методов. У меня два вопроса. Первый вопрос касается, оба касаются feature-rich модели, то есть второй, который вы представили. Вопрос первый. Значит, правильно ли я понимаю, что вы применяете mean-field variational inference для обучения модели?
Это громкое название для того, что это делается. То есть реально вместо маршинализации используется posterior mean и берется производная от posterior mean.
То есть, да. Собственно, вопрос такой. То есть вы упомянули о том, что вы используете negative sampling для настройки этих векторов представлений слов. И правильно ли я понимаю, что вы это делаете так же, как и авторы, как Миколов, который предложил технику для того, чтобы не считать нормализовочную эту константу в софтмаксе? И если так, тогда как вы обосновываете применение negative sampling? То есть ведет ли это к максимизации какого-то критерия, там, вариационной нижней оценки или чего-то, что вы оптимизируете? Потому что это выглядит как такая некоторая эвристика.
Да, мы используем negative sampling, да, мы используем примерно то же самое, что используется Миколовым. То есть это, по сути, мы пытаемся вариант, который правильный, ранжировать выше случайного сэмпла. В принципе, это может рассматриваться как эквивалент матричной факторизации. И если вам интересны детали, была статья на НИПСИ в этом году, Омера Леви и Йоффа Глоберсона, где детально рассматривается это.
Да, я имел в виду то, что то есть, строите ли вы на основе вот этого negative sampling в каком-то месте, используете ли вы как часть EM-алгоритма того или иного, или нет?
Как часть…
EM-алгоритма.
Нет, ну как такового EM-алгоритма там, там нету, да, то есть это как раз именно объектив, ну, который снаружи, из которого берется производная, и она пропагатится через обе модели, правильно?
Ну, в общем, нет строгого обоснования того, почему это ведет к максимизации, то есть именно вашего… понятно, что это приводит к улучшению представлений, но непонятно, можно ли это использовать для там, максимизации той или иной метрики, отличной от negative sampling.
Почему я, наверное, не совсем понимаю вопрос.
То есть, если мы делаем negative sampling, мы, да, ранжируем правильные слова выше, чем шум. Но почему, делая это, мы максимизируем то, что нужно, грубо говоря, вам, вот в метрике, которую вы оптимизируете?
Ну, просто можно, наверное, сказать по-другому, потому что исходные метрики у меня нету тоже хорошей теоретической мотивации, так почему бы мне ее тогда не изменить слегка? Потому что, в принципе, конечно, мы не хотим не предсказывать слова, мы, возможно, хотим что-то другое предсказывать. Мы хотим предсказывать семантические парсы, но у нас нет. Это, по сути, некий auxiliary task, который нам помогает, который, я думаю, что он имеет отношение непосредственно к предсказыванию семантического парсера. Я на последнем слайде здесь я упоминал, что возможный вариант именно обучения для инференса, то есть ты пытаешься предсказывать не аргумент, а предсказывать нечто другое, которое больше будет соответствовать инференс-проблеме, которая тебя интересует. И это может зависеть от конкретной даже задачи, то есть для чего вы хотите использовать этот парсер, для вот такого рода инференсов. Тогда для него и обучайте.
Ясно. Спасибо. И второй вопрос касается тоже feature-rich модели. Значит, правильно ли я понимаю, что в ней тоже есть какой-то непараметрический байс, то есть там тоже происходит какая-то кластеризация тех же ролей, скажем, слов, которые потом станут ролью?
Нет, там не происходит кластеризация, там есть представление слов, то есть есть вектора.
А, то есть они уже как бы выполняют роль?
Да, они выполняют эту роль.
Ясно, спасибо.
Пожалуйста.
Я слышал, вернее, мне известно, что вы помимо этой проблемы также изучали совместный синтетический и семантический анализ. Вот. И, в принципе, мне эта проблема очень интересна. Вот. И такой вопрос. Вы как-то пытались использовать эти вот автоматические кластеризованные роли для вот этой вот решения задачи совместного синтетического и семантического анализа?
Нет. Короткий ответ – нет. Но это также как бы… Да, действительно, я этим занимался до этой модели. И это в каком-то смысле мотивировало, ну, просто вызвало интерес мне заниматься именно совместной моделированием синтаксиса семантики для индукшена семантики. Но то, что мы увидели там, это то, что мы за счет совместного моделирования мы получали улучшение семантики, но не улучшение синтаксиса. Это немножко неожиданный, может быть, результат, но это также как бы мотивировало как раз то, что я не хочу в данном случае синтаксически парсить внутри этой модели. То есть я считаю, что синтаксис не изменяю, я моделирую семантику поверх этого. В принципе, понятно, что использовать эти роли для предсказания ролей именно аннотированных лингвистом, это тоже хорошая очень идея, и тем более, что она еще может рассматриваться как способ evaluation, да, то есть я использую эти метрики кластеризации, но что я мог сделать, например, использовать как дополнительные фичи в существующем FrameNet supervised semantic parser'е. Это то, что я планирую делать, и думаю, что это ну, имеет большой смысл.
Спасибо. А еще второй вопрос по поводу названия ролей. Мы раз говорили о том, что называть роль не нужно, я абсолютно согласен с этим, потому что, в общем-то, так работают системы аналитические. Вот, но вопрос такой, как сопоставить, допустим, вот задачи question answering, сопоставить семантику кластеризованной роли, выведенной роли, с семантикой вопроса. Такой классической проблеме, как, например, ну, изучение информации, изучение сущности из.
Ну, я, во-первых, сразу же отвечу, что я не специалист по question answering, буду откровенен. Но я, конечно, предполагаю, что то, что мы делали здесь, но, по сути, это реплицированные эксперименты Пунана и Домингоса, это, конечно, наивный подход, когда полностью практически матчится представление квешена и вопрос и ответ. И должна использоваться модель для определения соответствия, мне кажется, что это.
То есть нужно еще какой-то все-таки обучающий корпус для решения задачи question answering?
Ну, это зависит от конкретной, мне кажется, проблемы. То есть если это если сама question answering задача, она достаточно узкая, то, возможно, можно замэпить просто эти квешены на эти вопросы на семантику. Если это тоже open domain question answering, то я сомневаюсь, что удастся просто таким простым сопоставлением. Если ее решать реально с инженерной точки зрения, я думаю, что все равно потребуется использовать различные типы сигналов, а не использовать только предсказания нашей модели.
Спасибо.
Пожалуйста.
Спасибо большое за доклад. Такой вопрос. Вот вы сказали насчет анализа нескольких предложений, что, в принципе, эта модель для него не очень подходит. Такой вопрос. Что, собственно, мешает создавать вот такой же, граф, как мы создавали из одного предложения, несколько объектов соединять связями логическими, но брать за единицу анализа не одно предложение, как лексическую единицу, а, допустим, абзац текста, и считать, что в нем описываются одни и те же объекты. То есть, допустим, вот у нас было предложение про полицию, которая что-то там с демонстрантами сделала. Допустим, у нас в абзаце продолжается описание ситуации. Mm-hmm. То есть, ну, понятно, что у нас используют те же лексические категории и те же лексемы. Будет ли этот метод работать в данном случае, как вы считаете?
Тут, если впрямую реализовывать то, что вы говорите, я подозреваю, что просто получится, что абстрактно этот метод будет работать, но мы это никогда не узнаем, потому что не дождемся. Вот. А обычно PhD студенты, им нужно через 4 года получить диссертацию. Вот. Но есть вещи, которые можно использовать, как я думаю, что промежуточные подходы. То есть, например, мы рассматривали вариант дополнительных скрытых переменных, которые шарятся между отдельными предложениями в тексте. То есть можно сказать, они как топи, как. Вот я поэтому не говорил, не делал доклад на русском, как темы в тексте, то есть топики в тексте, которые помогают производить disambiguation для фреймов. Вот. Но я говорю о том, что это неприменимо, это сложно сделать, чтобы это все заработало очень хорошо для предыдущей модели. Ну, возможно, у вас есть идеи, но мне просто пока достаточно сложно представить, как это сделать эффективно. Но для второй модели, я как раз, я думаю, что она очень подходит для этой.
Спасибо.
Пожалуйста.
Иван, спасибо за доклад. Вопрос следующий. Вы пробовали применять вот эти результаты исследований только для одного языка, только для английского?
Мы серьезно использовали это для немецкого. Это вот в ACL 2012 статье, вы можете посмотреть на моей странице. Мы также у нас есть эксперименты на чешском, испанском. То есть у нас проблема в том, что нам нужно экспериментировать там, где мы можем померить, правильно? То есть там, где есть аналоги фреймнетов. Но эти результаты, в принципе, у нас не опубликованы, но если вам интересно, можем рассказать, что происходит.
Пробовали ли применять результаты исследований для извлечения семантики из текста на русском?
Нет.
Нет?
Я никогда не работал с русским.
Спасибо за ответ.
Но как раз хочу этим заняться. Угу.
Я так понимаю, что предикатные слова в основном были глаголы, да? Верно?
Нет, не совсем, но смотря до каких Окей, для каких статей, для каких экспериментов, для каких вещей?
То есть вы пытались как-то, как-то строить то же самое для предикатных существительных?
Ну да, но я вот там, где я показывал, в принципе, то есть предполагается, что любая часть вот этой dependency tree — это, в принципе, часть какого-то семантического класса, поэтому какое распределение у тебя в данных есть глаголов и существительных, так мы, собственно, и обрабатывали. Вот. Но да, здесь есть нюанс, что измеряли мы в основном на глаголах, просто потому что и потом, наверное, здесь придется детальный ответ дать, потому что PropBank — это только глаголы, а FrameNet имеет определенную проблему, что он аннотировал…
NumBank еще.
Окей, это офлайн. FrameNet, я знаю, оно в NumBank, но я не думаю, что он… идеальный ресурс. Вот. Но есть FrameNet, конечно, который как бы естественное место, где нам эволюировать. Это, но с ним есть проблема, что когда его аннотировали, не было синтекса, то есть лингвист аннотировал поверх текста, и, соответственно, спаны во многих случаях не соответствуют конституентам в деревьях. То есть они и, в принципе, не… И есть некое несогласие как раз по границам, поэтому все это очень сложно померить. И наша модель поверх синтекса, и PropBank поверх синтекса. А для других, мы как раз для этого, в частности, с немецким и занимались, потому что эта ошибка, в общем-то, была уже исправлена в немецком FrameNet, в Сальсе, где они уже аннотировали поверх синтекса, и, да, и там мы смотрели на существительные.
Хорошо. Вот вы сказали, что, в общем-то, задача unsupervised парсинга именно синтетического какая-то слишком сложная. Почему вы считаете так?
Синтаксического самого сложного, да, и unsupervised?
Синтаксического. Я сначала работаю, там, которые проводили в Стэнфорде, по-моему, даже вот недавно PhD был выпущен по поводу как раз таки unsupervised синтетического парсера. Они, в принципе, добивались, по-моему, там порядка 70 UAS. И…
Ну, тут есть… то есть я бы не сказал, что зависит, что понимается под сложным. То есть, наверное, здесь…
С вашей точки зрения, что-то типа этого для вот синтаксиса?
Мне кажется, что это больше вопрос целесообразности, а не сложности, потому что в синтаксисе очень сложно побить. То есть, в общем-то, вы упоминаете эти, например, числа. Системы, которые, например, занимались люди в Гугле, и которые перемещали парсер с одного языка на другой практически без адаптации, только адаптации лексики, получали лучшие числа, чем unsupervised системы, unsupervised syntax induction. И обычно исследователи в области unsupervised syntax induction, они говорят, что нет, просто у нас грамматика другая. Но… Насколько понимаю, сейчас приходит к выводу, что это, ну, не совсем хорошо работает, скажем так. Но у нее есть еще другой аргумент. Это, ну, cognitive, и, например, моделировать child language acquisition. И вот с этой точки зрения это интересно. То есть пытаться моделировать ситуацию, как люди, возможно, начинают понимать грамматику, но это немножко не соответствует моему, ну, общему направлению работы.
Спасибо.
Угу. Спасибо вам.
Поэтому зададим последний вопрос. И…
Precision вы оценили с помощью Purify. А recall каков?
Recall, к сожалению, оценить на biomedical data, да?
И по PropBank тоже.
Не, PropBank я оцениваю Precision Recall. Это F1 было. Это было Harmonic Mean Precision Recall. Для вопросов там проблема в том, что мы не знаем, он не полностью аннотированный корпус, поэтому у нас нет способа…
Ну, а в количестве глаголов?
В количестве…
Ну, если взять, что в английском языке, допустим, там 25-30 тысяч глаголов, а у вас сколько?
Не, у нас они все, которые возникали в корпусе, то есть это вопрос, нашли ли мы все хорошие кластеры или для них, или нет. Это… Мы же не выбираем ту составляющую, для которой мы производим это обучение.
То есть для каждого глагола, который встретился, вы хоть что-то предсказали?
Ну, для каждого глагола, чтобы встретиться, конечно, мы предсказываем, да. То есть это мы полностью предсказываем, все эволюируется на всем. Поэтому, в принципе, там нету такого понятия, как там, по сути, это accuracy. Единственный там был нюанс — это purity и collocation для пробанка, потому что комбинация двух вещей. Я не точно сейчас выразился. И вот там мы брали F1 между purity и collocation, но там у нас нет возможности не генерировать ничего и получить хороший результат.
Спасибо.
Пожалуйста. Спасибо.